God's trying to get our attention too. But God's not a pest, and he doesn't poke, and he doesn't tap, and he doesn't say your name 1,000 times, and he doesn't eat 1,000 cookies until finally he gets your attention. God's a lot better at getting our attention. And he does stuff like this. Last night, did you guys happen to go outside? Did you see the moon last night?
Yes.
It was gorgeous. Was it full last night? I think it was full last night. It was beautiful, and the stars on a cold night. Just brilliant. There were like more stars out last night than there have been in a long time, I think. All right? So there's stars. And God's going, hey, watch how beautiful I can make the sky. Boom. God's trying to get your attention. Sometimes God gets your attention through other things like this. Oh, my goodness, we just sang this great song. Did you guys sing that song? Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sometimes he gets your attention through music. Sometimes he gets your attention through your parents. Sometimes he gets your attention through... Wait a minute, I just thought of one. I mentioned all good things. God sometimes uses tough things to get your attention, like, do you remember your birthday party when you went ice skating? That was your birthday? I thought that was her birthday. Is she the one that got hurt? Your birthday, she gets hurt. Okay, that's what it was. And didn't you have to get stitches or something? And suddenly, oh, sadness, toughness, injury, ruined birthday party. Sometimes that gets your attention. But God's trying to get your attention. That's what he's trying to do. And he wants to get your attention because he really likes you. He loves you and he wants to talk to you. So whether it's the full moon last night or whether it's a tough situation at somebody's birthday party, realize God's trying to get your attention and he wants to talk to you and tell you that he loves you and he likes you. Let me pray with you guys. Thank you, Jesus, for trying to get our attention. And thanks for not ignoring us like sometimes our parents do when we're in the grocery. And thank you for not being a pest when you try to get our attention, not poking us or pulling on us or eating 100 cookies, but thank you for not giving up either and getting our attention any way you can, because we need to hear that you love us and that you like us and that you've forgiven us and that you're our Savior. We need to hear that. So as you put the full moon out there and we see that, help us to remember that you made it. And as we have things that are tough, whether it's a little bit of stitches or going to the doctor or getting a cavity, whatever it is, when you speak to us, let us hear you and let us hear your message. Thank you for these children. I pray in your name. Amen. See you guys. Let me pray for us, and then I'm going to open the word. Father, in the choir's anthem this morning, they sang pretty familiar words. I take, O cross, thy shadow for my abiding place. I ask no other sunshine than the sunshine of his face. Those lyrics are good lyrics, Lord, and the choir delivered them well, but to really mean them, that's a challenge for us, that we take as our only sunshine you. Boy, that's a challenge. We need to be able to see the sunshine from your face. And I pray that through your word this morning, Lord, we could see the sunshine from your face and that we would be somehow content to look to the light of your face instead of all the other things we look to for light sources. Please open your word to us. Allow our hearts to receive what you have for us and allow us to leave this place today as people who are changed because we were here worshiping our God. We pray in your name, Jesus. Amen. Okay, so how many of you out there like to fish? You're fishermen or fisherwomen. Everybody like, can I see Mike? Okay. Not me. I don't get fishing. I don't understand fishing. I'm not any good at fishing. I'm really bad at fishing. But from a theoretical standpoint, I just don't get it. I just don't get fishing. So when some friends of mine asked me to go up to Coldwater a few summers ago and go fishing, I was like, you guys are going to be there, right? Because I get people. I like people. I just don't like fishing. And so I don't know what the women did when the guys went out on the boat. But we were out on the boat, and Randy and Scott were like, they're on the boat, and they know how to fish. Like, Randy instinctively knows that a fish is coming up to his line. I don't know until I don't have anything on my hook that a fish came, right? And I just don't know how I'm supposed to know that. But Randy knows instinctively, and so he's a really good fisherman, and he knows what kind of fish it is before it even comes up. Scott's the same way, and so these guys are just having a riot. I'm just having a good time because I'm with my friends, right? All of a sudden, Scott has one on. I mean, it's not the first fish they caught that day, but it's, I mean, this is a good one. And so all the attention goes to that side of the boat. And Randy's like, oh, Randy's got, oh, and you know, and Scott's working it and doing whatever fishermen do. And I'm into it, right? I'm like, I'm seeing the bend of the pole. I'm like, this is going to be a big fish. And all of a sudden, as the fish gets pretty close and Randy's getting the net down in the water, all of a sudden, all this excitement turns to disappointment. And I don't get this. I thought the point of fishing was to try to hook a really huge fish, reel it in, get it in the boat so that you can either cut it up and eat it later, or if it's a really good fish, you can like take it to some guy, pay him lots of money, and then put a dead animal on your wall in your den. I thought that was the point of fishing. And all of a sudden, this excitement over this fish, and this fish, I mean, I saw it, it was in the net. It's good, 23-inch fish, and this isn't a fisherman's story, because I'm not a fisherman, so I wouldn't tell one of those stories. This huge fish suddenly turns from delight to, Scott says to Randy, don't even let that thing touch the deck of my boat. Keep it down in the water. And Scott goes and he gets pliers, and from down over the side of his boat, he unhooks the fish, and he's like calling it names. He goes, it's a dogfish. I'm thinking, oh, it's a dog of a fish. Dogfish, catfish, rainbow trout, I don't care what it is. It's huge, and it should be like taken to a guy and put on his wall. I went home later, because they were both just cursing this fish. I went home later and did what a non-fisherman does. I Googled dogfish. I thought it was a nice big fish. I didn't understand why we didn't eat it that night, but Google and Randy and Scott said this is a worthless fish, lots of teeth, no meat, no flavor, and you don't even want it to touch the deck of your boat. Go figure, I don't get fishing. I just don't get it. We've been spending the last few weeks looking at the words of Jesus. And we're going to hit Jesus today when Jesus is going to reach out to fishermen, and he's going to talk the language of fishermen in order to hook fishermen, pun intended. He's going to reel them in. Oh, it's bad. Because he's talking their language, all right? But I want to review a little bit about where we've been. We've been looking over the last 3 or 4 weeks about the words of Jesus in the order that they come to us, from the youngest time we hear Jesus speak to the next time, to the next time. This is about the last time that we can order, hey, this came next, and then it just, you know, Jesus is talking on top of himself. But the first time was when Jesus was 12, and he gets separated from his family, and they're on this little vacation thing to Jerusalem to Passover, and Jesus gets separated. His parents go home. Then they start to come back, and they go, we haven't seen you for 3 days, and why did you do this to us? And Jesus speaks, first time we hear him, and he says, why were you searching for me? And I know that the question goes to the situation, but I think that's the question that Jesus asks humans for the rest of human history. Why were you searching for me? Because Jesus is searching for us. Why were you searching for me? It's a great question from a 12-year-old Jesus. We don't hear from Jesus for 18 years after that until he's 30 years old. He's at his baptism. And he goes up to John the Baptist and he says, John, will you please baptize me? And John says, I don't even deserve to touch your sandals. No, I won't baptize you. And Jesus says, and I'm going to paraphrase his words. He says, look, John, you don't know what's going on right now. But I'm working on a bigger picture and I need you to do this because I'm working on something bigger than you right now. And John the Baptist baptizes Jesus. Right after that, Jesus goes out for about a month into the wilderness, about 40 days, and he is tempted by the enemy. And in the next time we hear Jesus talk is when he kind of says to Satan, and again, I'm paraphrasing, he says to Satan, Satan, you know what you need? You need to go to a Bible study, and I'm going to be your teacher. And Jesus just lays out scripture for him. That's the next time we hear Jesus speak. And then last week, we looked at Jesus when he launches. This is just days later. He launches his preaching ministry with a 16-word sermon. He says, the time has come. The kingdom of God is near. Repent, which means change your thinking and believe the good news. And now Jesus is going to take that operation, that 16-word sermon, and he's going to start translating it into different languages, not literal languages, but today he's going to talk to fishermen, and he's going to take that message, repent, change your thinking, and believe the good news. And he's going to take it and he's going to put it into the language of fishermen. If you have your New Testament this morning, it's Mark chapter 1. Most of the Gospels record this story, but I want to go to Mark's account of the story. Mark chapter 1. And we're going to pick it up in verse 14 so that we get the summary of his 16-word sentence, and then a couple more paragraphs, we'll see Jesus translating that message into the language of fishermen. Mark chapter 1, verse 14. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said, the kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come follow me, Jesus said. Come follow me, Jesus said. This is the next time Jesus speaks. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them. And they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men, and they followed him. So one of the important parts of Bible study, one of the principles of Bible study, is you never interpret meaning in the isolation of a text. You have to see a bigger picture. You have to see a little bit of context. And we get a little bit of context here. The context is Jesus has launched his preaching ministry, and his whole sermon can be boiled down to 16 words, and it's summed up in the last part of his sermon, repent, meaning change your thinking wrong, change your thinking, and believe the good news of the kingdom. That's to believe in God's kingdom. That's the context. But Mark's gospel really condenses this story. You don't need to turn there, but I'm going to tell you what Luke tells us in his version of this story. A few more details. Luke actually shows us what happens a few days before this. And what happens a few days before this is Jesus is in town, and he goes into a guy's house, and the guy is Simon the fisherman. He goes into Simon's house, and he finds that Simon's mother-in-law has a fever. And Jesus has compassion on her, so he goes, hey, we need to get rid of that fever. Boom, fever gone. Jesus uses a miracle in order to get rid of her fever and to get Simon's attention. But then the story in Luke's gospel is a little fuller on what happens the day of the fishing expedition. It says in Luke chapter 5 that Simon and his brother Andrew were business partners with James and John, sons of Zebedee, these two boats together. They're actually business partners. And they've been fishing all night long. And it's not the kind of fishing that I do poorly, where you throw something in the water with a hook on it. No, it's net fishing, sometimes done from the shore, sometimes done from the boat. And these guys have been at it all night long, and they haven't gotten anything. It's just been a horrible night of fishing. And Luke's gospel says that they're exhausted, and they're washing out their nets. They're done. They're going home. They're going to take a nap. And Jesus walks up onto the scene. He actually is a little aggressive. He just stomps out, wades out into the water, and gets in one of the boats. And he goes, let's go fishing. And Peter, Simon, who will later be called Peter, says to him, hey, Jesus, we've been at this all night long. The fish aren't jumping in the net tonight. All right, it's just not going to happen. But since I like you, I guess I'll do what you say. And so the fishermen get back in the boat, and they row out, and they drop their nets down. And guess what happens? The nets are full of fish. So many fish are starting to tear their nets. So they reel them in. These exhausted fishermen who have been at it all night long reel in the nets, and the fish now swamp the boats and almost sink their boats. They've been at it all night long. They get nothing. Jesus gets in the boat, and a miracle happens, and they get so many fish, it almost sinks their boats. And Simon's reaction to that is this. He says, get away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. And that's when Jesus speaks fisherman language to the fishermen. And he says, you follow me, and I'm going to make you fisher of men. 11 words this time. 11 words. Jesus says, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. 11 words. Come, follow me. We have to stop right there. I couldn't stand it. I had to look up. Is there anything I can learn from the original language that would give me insight into this? Yeah. Come. Come is kind of like this. I'm going to scare you. Come! I told you I was going to scare you. Why'd you jump? I mean, I did warn you on that one, right? Come is not just come, follow me. It's not gentle. It's not come. It's a, hey, you. It is a Greek word that it does mean come. It means you're over there. I need you to come here. But it's a hey you. I was riding in the car. Linda was driving. I was riding in the passenger seat. It was summer. Windows were down. We're in Englewood on 48, so you can picture this down by Meyer. And we're at the stoplight there, and this van rolls up next to me. I didn't notice it until the guy in the van who had his window down looked down at me and goes, hey! And I look, I mean, I almost jumped through my seatbelt. I mean, I almost got bruises on this one. And I looked up, and it's one of my dumb friends. He's just getting my attention to say hi. It's like, next time don't yell at me during the sermon or when I'm driving. Come, Jesus says. It's yelling. It's, hey, you. And then he says, follow me, which means get behind me. Join my team. I want you on my team. Hey, you, get on my team. I want you on my team. That's what Jesus says. And then he says this. And I will make you fishers of men. And suddenly the message gets translated into the language of fishermen that I don't understand. I want you to realize something here. Jesus is a bit relentless when he tries to get your attention. This is the third come, is the third hey you that Jesus has used on Simon and his brother Andrew. The first one was when he healed his mother-in-law from the fever. The second one was when he loaded the boat full of fish. And now he uses words and he says, hey you, come. He gets his attention. Jesus is a little relentless. But isn't Jesus a little relentless with you and me? I mean, you think about back through your life to the times when God has gotten your attention and all the different methods that God uses to get your attention. Sometimes he fills your boat with a lot of fish. I don't mean it literally, I mean it figuratively. Sometimes God just pours out blessing and you sit there and you go, I do not deserve what you're doing here. I tried my way, I tried fishing, it didn't work, and look at you, God. You are blessing me beyond what I could ever deserve. Sometimes God uses good things and blessing. Yeah. You have a grandbaby. You have a baby. You find love and get married. You know, you get a job promotion. Whatever it is this blessing. And you go, I didn't deserve that. Thank you, God. But sometimes the boat is almost ready to sink, but it's not because of blessing. You're taken on water. The doctor said, hey, I don't like what I'm seeing. I'm going to order up a test. And you get the test, and it's not a good result. And all of a sudden, your boat's about ready to sink because of fear and sadness and despair. And yeah, that, hey, God has your attention. God has a lot of different ways to get your attention. And when he says, hey, you to Simon and Andrew and James and John, he is getting their attention because God tends to be pretty relentless about getting their attention. And he says, hey, you got my attention. Follow me. I want you on my team. And then the language of the fishermen. And I will make you fishers of men. Is that significant that Jesus is speaking the language of fishermen to fishermen? Well, when you look at the story of Jesus and you read through the Gospels and you just see Jesus interacting with people, I find it interesting. You remember when Jesus is walking through town that one time? And there are all kinds of crowds following him. He's got quite a following now. Because he's doing all these miracles. He's healing people. He's casting out demons. He's forgiving sins. He's making lepers have no skin problems. I mean, Jesus has a following now. And there's a lady that has been struggling for a dozen years with some kind of a bleeding incident, and no doctor can solve it. And this lady believes so much in Jesus that she says, if I could just work my way through the crowd and reach out and just touch the edge of his garment, I know he would heal me. He's just that powerful. And so sure enough, she works her way through the crowd. Jesus doesn't even know she's in this crowd. She reaches out, she touches the edge of his garment, and immediately she can tell she's healed from this 12-year illness, and Jesus stops. And Jesus says something that his disciples say, that's absurd. Jesus says, who touched me? And they're like, Jesus, everybody's touching you. We're Arabs, right? Arabs like close community. They bump into each other as they walk. That's just how their culture is. And they say, that's absurd to say, who touched me? Everybody's touching you. And he goes, no. Somebody in need just touched me, and I want to know who it is. The lady thinks Jesus is mad at her. But she raises a hand. She says, I did. I've been bleeding for 12 years, and I knew if I just touched. And Jesus does not say to her, well, now that you're fixed, come and follow me and I'll make you a fisher of men. Jesus doesn't say that, does he? When Jesus sees Matthew, the tax collector, who is a dirty, rotten, scoundrel IRS agent, Jesus does not call him. I shouldn't say that during tax season, should I? Jesus does not say to him, Matthew, follow me, and I will make you a fisher of men. When Jesus is comforting the mourners when Lazarus died, he doesn't say, don't cry, you guys. Just follow me, and I'll make you fisher of men. When Jesus is in the parade route, and little Zacchaeus, the wee little man, climbs up in the sycamore tree to get the sight of Jesus, Jesus does not say to him, now, Zacchaeus, you come down and follow me, and I'll make you a fisher of men. When Jesus is in that Bible study, and he's teaching, and the house is just filled with people, and the friends with the paralyzed buddy tear a hole in the ceiling and lower the paralyzed man in front of Jesus, he doesn't say, son, your sins are forgiven. Now come and follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. When Jesus is dealing with the woman caught in the very act of adultery, and they're going to stone her, Jesus doesn't say, where are your accusers? Therefore, I don't accuse you. Go and sin no more, and come and follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. When Jesus is speaking to fishermen, he speaks the language of fishermen. But when Jesus is, he uses a language of healing when he's talking to people who are sick, and he uses a language of forgiveness when he's talking to people who have wandered, and he uses a language of comfort to people who are mourning. He uses a language of reconciliation to people who have relationship disasters. He uses a language of do-over to people who tend to wander away from him. But when he's talking to guys who know what a dogfish is, he speaks to them in the language of fishermen. And he says, you come. I want you on my team. And I'm going to make you into fishers of men. I read this passage here in Mark and in Luke and in Matthew, and I'm left with two questions for me that I'm going to push to you. I get tired of being the forehead of Goliath and God being David throwing a rock and hitting me only, so I'm going to let it bounce off and hit you too, okay? Two questions. One, what is Jesus using to get your attention? Come. Hey, you. Sometimes crisis, sometimes blessing, and everything in between. Sometimes a full moon on a clear night. Hey, you. What is Jesus using to get your attention? He tends to be relentless in getting our attention. And number two, the question that I'm left with is this. What language does Jesus use when he wants to reach you? If you're a fisherman, he might talk to you about dogfish and fishers of men. But if you're like me and you're not a fisherman, he might talk to you through the words of a hymn, because it's really just poetry set to music. I'm an English guy. What is the language that God is using to communicate with you? May God add his blessing to the reading and explanation of his word.